Let us continue our discussions about the geometric characteristics of random fields. Last time we discussed that if we have some parametric subset D in RD and we have a one-dimensional Gaussian random field acting from D to R, such that it is centered, and have a covariance such that the following condition holds. For example, that we have the finiteness of such integral where J U V is the determinant of we have gamma U gamma V gamma V U gamma V. Then one can prove that there exists a local time at any point x which belong to R, which is equal to formally to integral delta x psi u du. We already said that this integral for smooth function psi is related to its derivative. But what happened if psi is non-smooth? And last time I promised that we discuss we will discuss this local times as a geometric characteristics of our random field. And today we begin with this, and I will consider a slightly different situation because of one-dimensional random field is not too interesting in modeling. Is not too interesting in the modeling of molecules in mathematical biology. So it is better to have two-dimensional or three-dimensional random fields. So let me show you example of the random curve in two dimensions, Euclid space. I will consider space R2, and now we want to have a parametric set as the interval 0, 1. So we will consider a curve. For example, here is a real line. This is interval 0, 1, and here is R2. And we will have the mapping. I will consider this random mapping consisting of two coordinates from T. And here we'll have some random curve. Now let us take an example. That Xi1 and Xi2 will be independent. Identically distributed. Distributed. And I will suppose that they are centered. and that covariance has the following form, special form. I will excuse me. Oh, да. Okay, so we have such covariance for one coordinate, and I will suppose that alpha is from 0, 1. We discussed it already that for such alpha, we can guarantee the existence of the local time. But now we consider two-dimensional case. So so now we consider x from R2 and using the same arguments as before, one can check that there exists local time at x, which can be formally written as the integral from 0 to 1 delta 0 from our psi t dt. For a moment, I put here a rule, because psi is, delta x. Maybe it is better to write it everywhere, because these are elements of R2, psi1 and psi2. It is interesting that there exists a relationship between this local time and visitation measure of the our random curves. Let us define visitation measure. Visitation measure. Mu from the set delta for delta subset of R2 as follows. This is equal to integral from 0 to 1. Here we have indicator of delta from psi t dt. In other words, this is a time which our curve spanned in the set delta, and here is parametric set 0, 1. We just on this picture consider the time interval during which our curve travels inside of the set delta. Of course, this the set of such t for which psi t belongs to delta can be much more complicated structure, but in the picture we have some interval where we travel, and the length of this interval is exactly mu of this visitation measure of our random curve. Because of this delta function here and the indicator here, one can imagine already that we have a good relationship between delta, local time, and this delta. And this is a so-called occupation formula. And we will write it as follows. Uh, for every f which is acting from R2 to R bounded and measured we have the following relation that the integral with respect to R2 f of x mu dx is equal to integral from 0 to 1 f of xi t dt. And is equal to and is equal to integral f of x L of x. From this point of view, one can see that local time is just Radon nicotine derivative of our visitation measure mu. By the way, it can be seen from the definition. Maybe you remember that we use approximation to define the local time. And one of the possible approximations was exactly the following. We substitute this delta concentrated at the point x by the indicator of the small ball now of radius epsilon divided on its area. So this tends to delta x. And we can substitute it there. Then one can use the occupation formula and get that we have exactly the procedure how we calculate Radon nicotine derivative of the measure mu when we try to establish existence of the local time. So in our case, we have such kind of relationship. By the way, this relationship gives us very interesting consequence because it shows that we have very strange random curve now. See what happened. Now we begin to discuss geometry characteristics. See what happened. If I suppose that, for example, function h is acting from 0, 1 to R2 and is smooth, then when we imagine the picture related to H, it can be drawn like following. We have here this H, and here we have some smooth curve. Yes. Let us define the image of H. Let's denote it by K. K is equal to H from 0, 1. And if I ask you, what is the Lebesgue area of K? The answer will be zero, of course. So if we consider Lebesgue measure two-dimensional, because we are living in the flat, now two-dimensional Lebesgue measure of the K is equal to zero. Yeah, it is evident because from school years we know that if we have, for example, some segment in the plane, its area is equal to zero. And for smooth curve, everybody can try to approximate its area just drawing a small tube around this K, and then this small tube has a area which tends to zero when the size of the tube tends to zero. So we have such a behavior. But now let us recall that for our random curve defined by Xi, its visitation measure has a density now. And we have such a relationship. So now let us think about the area. Let us think about the area of the Xi. I will denote it by K again, Xi of 0, 1. This is a random compact. Why I said compact? Because we already discussed it with you that for such covariance function, the modification, Gaussian modification of Kolmogorov condition gives us continuity. So I know that this guy is a continuous image of closed interval 0, 1. So K is compact. Is compact. Now ask the same question. What is the area? What is the area of K? And see what happened. To understand the answer on this question, let us think what will be support of the random measure mu of occupation measure for our Xi. I just recall to you the occupation formula. Then we will see that integral from 0 to 1 indicator of some ball centered in the point x with the radius delta from xi t dt is equal to the mu of this ball b x delta. So if this is a set k, those image, and this is our set our point x, and point x does not belong to this compact, then there must exist such delta that this ball does not intersect K. So we will have here zero. Then it is also equal to zero. Then we understand that our X does not belong to the support of mu. So one can say in our case that support of mu is a subset of K. If we work much more hard, then one can check that it can be a good exercise that it is equal to K. So we can say now this one. Okay. Now suppose that our random curve is good in a sense of our geometric habits. What does it mean? It means that it has a zero area. Yes? If lambda 2 of K equals zero with probability one, then what will happen? We just take mu from R2. It will be like what? It will be like the integral from 0 to 1 of indicator of R2 of xi t dt, and it must be equal to 1, of course, yes. But from other side, let us use the fact that mu has a density, and it is equal integral with respect to R2 a of x dx. Here is local time, and now the last step is crucial, but evident. Because of this, one can substitute this R2 by k. So it is equal to integral with respect to k, Lx dx. But we already have an agreement that it is equal to zero, yeah? So I can continue and write it is zero. And we have this equality, one equal to zero. This contradiction leads to the fact that this is not true. So at least we can say now that with positive probability, the Lebesgue area of our random curve, that Lebesgue area of our random curve is greater than zero. We proved the following statement. It is strange. We understood now that our random curve is very chaotic. Maybe if we look back to first year of calculus, we have such an example. We have deterministic example, so-called piano carpet. And this piano carpet is exactly a non-random curve, such that its graph, for its graph, this is non-random curve acting from F is continuous, and F of 0, 1 is equal to 0, 1. But it is a complicated construction, but this construction looks like a construction of the fractal set, so it is very regular. But now we have chaotic random object, random curve, which is continuous, but have the property very similar to this one, yeah? We have positive area. We have positive area. Okay. Now let's look on the geometric characteristic of such random curve. To study it, I will recall you very well known fact from the usual deterministic geometry. The first formulation of this fact was following. Suppose that we have a convex body K is convex in RD, Rn. Then take epsilon, which is positive, and consider epsilon neighborhood of this body. Yes, epsilon. I will denote by V epsilon. This is n-dimensional. N-dimensional volume of this neighborhood. Of say K epsilon. K epsilon. Then it was proved probably 2 centuries ago that V epsilon is a polynomial with respect to epsilon. For arbitrary convex set, this is just a sum from k equals 0 to n. And here we have coefficients. I will put here binomial coefficients and here omega. Omega depending on our set eight, and here epsilon in power. So we have a polynomial from the epsilon, and here some numbers related to our compact set. Oh, excuse me, must be k small here. Because this is a set of numbers related to our compact sets can be found. And it occurs that this subset, this set of numbers, 0k, omega 1k, omega nk, has a geometry have a geometric meaning related to our set K. Maybe one can imagine that it is true. Yeah. Why? Because up to this normalization, this is just useful normalization for some relationship between such numbers. In different dimensions. But if you even forget about these coefficients, you can imagine why we can say that these numbers have geometric meaning. Actually, what will be the free coefficient? When we get this coefficient, when epsilon is equal to zero. So what is it? This is a volume of our convex body K. Then the next one, what is it? It is also simply because of when we have, for example, in this picture, the volume K of K epsilon, then you can imagine what is the coefficient for the first power of epsilon. We just consider such a rod of the size epsilon. So it is multiplied on the surface area of K. Yes. So this is a surface area and all other coefficients have the same meaning. They are so-called Minkowski functionals. Minkowski functionals of the convex body K. It was interesting that the people continue to study Minkowski functionals and define it in much more complicated case. They consider it not convex body K, but some smooth manifold, place it in the finite dimensional space. And it occurs that again, we can have the same formula, but these coefficients now are related to the integral curvatures of our manifold. So they are called Lipschitz. Maybe SC. Lipschitz healing curvatures. So one can see that we can get geometric characteristics of the manifold, random curve, or convex body initially from the from the asymptotic expansion of the volume of its epsilon neighborhood. Now we will do more or less the same just for our case. I will not show you exactly the same picture because of it is rather technical. But I will do more or less the same. You will see what I mean in a moment. Let us have the following picture. I will try to draw such picture. Here is our flat R2. Here is R2. This is one, and this is just some other coordinates. Suppose that this is our set K. I just recall you that our K is equal to the image psi of 0, 1. Then let's consider the epsilon neighborhood of K. I will denote it by K epsilon. And when we discuss the expansion, which I showed you before, I must consider lambda 2 of K epsilon. And as I said to you, it is not very easy to do it technically. So I just substitute this guy by something else, but very closely related to this thing. In such a way, you see, this guy is equal to what? If I draw here cylinder set of the attitude 1, then the volume of this set, so the integral with respect to R2 indicator of K epsilon x dx, is exactly our let me use another letter, our S epsilon, which we need to expand with respect to epsilon. Yeah, but it is difficult for me to do it. So what I will use, I just propose to consider not cylinders, but I propose to consider some function which also will be equal to 0 outside of this K epsilon and tends to 1 on the set K. So I will use another approximation, just a much more suitable approximation. How I will construct it? Let us consider the following function. For x, which belong to R2, I will put into correspondence such function h of x and epsilon, which is equal to 1 minus exponent. Here is the p. Minus 1 epsilon minus 2 1 over p epsilon 2 here is mu b x epsilon As before, in this formula, mu is an occupation measure, a measure of psi then B X epsilon as before is an open wall with the center of X and in X and radius epsilon. This is such wise that norm of X minus Y is less than epsilon. Now one can see what happens. If the distance between X and our compact set K is greater than epsilon, then this mu is equal to zero. We don't hit it. So we have zero here, we have zero here. So our function disappears outside of the epsilon neighborhood. Inside of epsilon neighborhood, it takes positive values. And you see, when we go to the zero, when we push epsilon go to the zero, we get here exactly what we get here this is not necessary. I already write it. Mm-hmm. Yes, I already wrote it. So we get here the positive value of local time. So we have also positive value when X belongs to K. H X epsilon tends to 1 minus E in X when epsilon tends to 0. Of course, it is not one, but more or less the situation is like here. Now let's think about the asymptotics of this expression, of the integral from this expression. And here you will see very interesting new formulas. Let us consider now such a value. I will denote it by S with tilde, which means that modified S epsilon. And it is equal to integral with respect to R2 from H X epsilon dx. This is a difference. Here we have H X, here we have the indicator of K epsilon. Then it will be equal to integral with respect to R2, 1 minus exponent, 1 P epsilon square mu B X epsilon dx. Now I just will use the expansion for the exponent. It's equal to integral with respect to R2. Here the sum from K equal 1 to infinity and then minus 1 in K plus 1, K factorial. And here we have the mu 1 P epsilon square mu B X epsilon in power in a power k And here is also this P epsilon square in the power k. Now we have the integral dx. What I'm going to do, I'm going to change the sum and the integrals, and I will get finally the following sum from k equal 1 to infinity minus 1 in k plus 1. Here is the integral with respect to R2, and here is 1 p epsilon square k mu bx epsilon in k dx. Now suppose that I can do all these things. By the way, formally it can be proved that this expression is right. And I will substitute this guy by its limit. So it tends to what? It tends to delta function. It tends to the integral from delta function at point x of psi t dt. Yes, in power k. Now see what happened. It's equal to sum of k 1 to infinity minus k plus 1 k factorial. And now what we have here, we have here the integral with respect to R2, and this integral in k power. I will rewrite this integral in what way? You remember from the student years that the product of the integrals is equal to multiple integral. So I will write here multiple integral 0 to 1 k, and here is delta x of psi t1 delta x of psi tk and dt1 dt1 dtk. And then, oh, excuse me, dt1 dtk dx. Then let's interchange the integration inside of this integral. What we will have? We will have the following. I just write separately this summand. We'll have the following. The multiple integral from 0 to 1 k time, here integral with respect to R2, delta x psi t1, delta x psi tk dx dt1 dt. What does it mean? You see, we calculate here such cases when all these guys, psi t1 and so on, psi tk, are equal actually, because we just integrate with respect to x. So what we will get? We will register such, we will register such cases when here we have I will put here delta zero from Xi T2 minus Xi T1 multiply and so on delta 0 Xi Tk minus Xi Tk minus 1. So we get self-intersection local time. Okay. Moreover, we just have this k factorial, and we can put it here, and then consider instead of this guy, we can consider simplex. We already know what it is. So if I denote now, maybe better to do it here. If I denote now this self-intersection local time by tk, then we have that this thing goes to the sum from k equal 1 to infinity minus 1 k plus 1 divided by k factorial tk of our random field. By the way, what it is? It is some general deep generalization of the exclusion inclusion formula for finite sets. And one can imagine where we get asymptotic expansion, because of here on this step we know that this guy came to this one with the same speed as we approximate Radon Nikodym derivative. Usually this is the power, such power of epsilon. So one can imagine that we already have asymptotic expansion of the our initial integral with some coefficients which are self-intersection local time for our random field psi. From this point of view, one can see one can say that these guys self-intersection local time are geometric characteristic for non-smooth random fields. And it occurs even much more interesting situation exists. And now I will go to the next example and begin it and try to show you that the same happened in much more interesting situation. Why I said much more interesting? Because our random curve related to the mapping psi actually was not a curve in our usual common sense. Yes, because we already discussed it with you that area of the curve must be equal to zero. So let's consider such an example. When area of the random curve is equal to zero, what happened in this case? And now I will take a very commonly distributed example. It is two-dimensional Wiener process. It occurs that for two-dimensional Wiener process, we have area equal to zero. So one can ask about, again, expansion of the epsilon neighborhood. And we can discuss what are the coefficients of this expansion again. This is the next example. Consider WT. This is Wiener process. In RD, R2. The first fact which we need is the following probability that lambda 2 of W0t is equal to 0 equal 1. How one can understand this? How one can prove this? By the way, it is not very simple fact. There are different proofs of this fact. I will consider the following way. Take an arbitrary function x, point x, which is not equal to zero. Not equal, maybe zero. And then consider the following. I will consider probability that x belongs to w from 0 to 1. And it occurs that this probability equal to 0. If we prove this, then by Fubini we have this. Just integrate with respect to x. So we just have to check this one relationship. How we can do this? It occurs that it can be done using Green function for Laplace equation on the plane. Suppose that here is our x, here and consider two circles. This is a one of a very small radius r small, and this is another one. This is another one of very big radius r big. Then one can try to understand the behavior of the Wiener process when we starting from zero. Actually, the full proof is not my aim, but I just give you an ideas. And the first idea is to prove that we leave this place between two shocks with probability one. Why we do this? Because if we consider subsequent steps like W1, W2 minus W1 and so on, if you consider such step, then the independent standard Gaussian vectors, so the sequence is unbounded. Due to this fact, we get that we will leave this space. And now one can try to calculate probability that we will leave this space through this border before, so this, so live in this way, not in this way. I just want to calculate probability of the event, which is good for us from the point of view of this proof, because I am going much more strong version of it to prove. Now it occurs that this probability satisfy Laplace equation, and here it is equal to one, here it is equal to zero, and due to symmetry we know the fundamental solution of Laplace equation on the plane, and this probability exactly equal to the following ratio. Here is a logarithm of r minus 1 minus a logarithm of r, and here is a logarithm of norm of x, minus logarithm of r minus 1 of r. Yeah. Now let's see what happens when r tends to 0 plus. Yeah. It goes to 1. So we understand that this probability 1 we will leave through the outer border. Yeah. When this small circle goes to the point. This is not a complete proof. I just omit technical steps, but this is an idea. And from this point of view, we see this relationship. Now it follows from Fubini theorem. If we just integrate this relationship with respect to Lebesgue measure, then one can see that lambda 2 of w from 0, 1 is equal to 0 with probability 1. Now, let us consider the neighborhood of this. So as before, I define k will be equal to w from 0, 1, and k epsilon is is epsilon neighborhood. Of k, yeah. Let S epsilon be area, and we again discuss what will be asymptotic expansion of S epsilon when epsilon tends to zero. One can say, okay, as before, we can try to define local time, self-intersection local time for this w. And then the answer will be the same as before. But the problem is that now there are no local time and there are no self-intersection local time. Let's check this. For example, if you consider integral from 0 to 1, here I will use approximation pi epsilon, which tends to delta 0, but this is density of the normal distribution with 0 mean and covariance equal to epsilon multiplied on the identity matrix in the space R2. Then if we consider here pi epsilon wt dt, then take simple condition, simple expectation of this guy. We already have seen the trick how we can calculate such kind of expectations, where Gaussian densities and values of Gaussian process are involved. Then it is equal to integral from 0 to 1, and here we have dt and here 2 pi and t plus epsilon. Eh? I think yes, because we have square root and we have a square inside of the determinant. Then we have square root of the determinant, but under this we have t plus epsilon, t plus epsilon square, so we have exactly such answer. One can see that it goes to plus infinity and epsilon goes to. So there are no local time, and of course there are no self-intersection local time and so on. We have to do something. And now we can do the trick which came from the quantum physics and is deeply related to quantum physics and is called renormalization. And we will begin our next lecture in the next week from the renormalization of the intersection local times for Wiener plots on the plane. And we will see that then Tuby formula still holds with this renormalized self-intersection local times. So from this lecture, which we have today, we can see that local times, self-intersection local times for non-smooth Gaussian random fields plays the same role as Lipschitz-Killing curvatures for smooth manifolds. So they are geometric characteristics of the random surfaces, random curves. Next lecture, we will finish the example related to Wiener plots and begin to move our random surfaces or curves just to understand how it changed the geometric characteristic. For today, this is the end of the lecture. Thank you for attention.
Yes. Here we you introduce we consider the result for two dimension.
Yes.
How about the high dimension?
Oh, in high dimensional case, there are different possibilities. You remember that in the beginning of our lecture, we discussed xi, which just acts from D. For example, we can organize psi which acting from D to Rn. Yes? Then, yes. Taking different covariance of psi with the same alpha as I mentioned, yeah? For example, here yeah. I can consider still 0, 1, yeah? Then, relation between alpha and will lead to different conditions on this alpha when self-intersection exists or some other or local time exists. We can produce such covariance that we will still have intersections. But if we discuss Wiener process, then it is known that in R3 it has only double intersections yeah. and not any multiple intersections. This is the difference between dimension 2 and 3. And here it has no self-intersections. From this point of view, the interesting question arises. What will be the asymptotic of tube? And now the answer can be followed. Let us do the following thing. Consider the multidimensional Wiener process, for example, in R3. Yeah? This is multi-dimensional, three-dimensional Wiener process. Then take it projections, for example, on this plane.
Yeah.
If we consider this plane, in the plane we have a two-dimensional Wiener process which has a lot of self-intersection.
Yeah.
Here one can define at least renormalized local times. Then one can try to make the geometric characteristics like Lipschitz-Killing curvature for this three-dimensional object, just integrating geometric characteristic of its projections. Because when it is convex body, it is true. We can get the Lipschitz or Minkowski functionals of convex body just using its projections and integrated over all family of planes. So now I have one guy in he's in Belgium, and he's working with me exactly on this subject. So this is open question. I think that we will get the answer exactly on this way. Yeah.
Oh.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah. Thanks. My second question.
Yes.
Is the injector space the, for example, the N is fixed, or maybe N is has a Hausdorff dimensional, is like not an integral.
Exactly. We can proceed in other way. You are right. One can define some function as far as I remember, these functions will be like T log T minus one. And using this function, one can try to define Hausdorff measure. And this yeah. measure of Wiener trajectory in the plane will be non-zero. Yeah, it can be done. There are a lot of work of Taylor on this subject. People study different things, this Hausdorff measure, or just a Hausdorff measure of a point of strictly two self-intersections, strictly three or with fixed number self-intersection and so on. So people do this work using Hausdorff measure, yeah. But you see, in our definition of delta function, we use Lebesgue measure. This is a difference. If we use yeah. another measure, then we can do maybe some other calculus, yeah? But in this case, we will miss something because you see this occupation formula is related to Lebesgue measure, not to the Hausdorff measure. So this is a problem. So this is one of the reasons why people don't define the local time with respect to this.
Thanks. I have no other question. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And let me congratulate everybody with the coming spring day. And I think we will meet after a week at February 17th.
Yeah. Nice Wednesday.
Okay. Okay, so have a good holiday.
Oh, bye. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Bye.